Hello, everyone. My name is Ann Mangelsdorf, and I am your host this evening. Welcome to this evening's webinar on meeting your child's needs using Charting the LifeCourse Tools in the IEP process. So now I'd like to introduce our speakers for this evening. These are two people that I have great respect for with regards to their knowledge and experience, and I'm looking forward to hearing their presentation this evening. Karen Cooper is a training specialist at Family Advocacy and Community Training, or F.A.C.T., and Deb Fiasco is an administrator at the Parent Education and Diversity Awareness Department at the Special School District.
Thanks so much. And thank you, everyone, for joining us for meeting your child's needs using the Charting the Life Course tools in the IEP process. Karen and I are hoping to give you some tools for planning that will really help you through this process and make it even more meaningful for your child. So we're going to get started. Karen, do you want to tell us a little bit about your organization?
Sure. Thank you. We said, my name is Karen Cooper. I'm the training specialist here at Family Advocacy and Community Training. We have a couple of programs that we do. Probably the biggest program that we have is our family support program, where we provide peer parent support or family support to parents who have children with developmental disabilities. We help them navigate those systems and make sure that their voice is heard and that they're a part of all of the decisions that are made about their child and their family. And then we also do educational advocacy, specifically looking at those issues in the school setting. And our advocates are highly trained, and we support parents in getting those services in the educational setting. I've been with F.A.C.T. for 16 years, and I am a parent. And my son is 28 years old, and he's on the autism spectrum.
Thanks. And I am Debra Fiasco. I'm with Special School District's Parent Education and Diversity Awareness Program. We are getting a facelift and a name change, so watch for that in the upcoming school year. But right now, I still work for PEDA. I've worked in this field for about a long time, about 20 years with the state of Missouri in the Developmental Disabilities Division. I've worked for provider agencies, and I've been with Special School District now for 7 years. The Parent Education Program, we have lots and lots of resources. We do workshops like this, some on our own. A lot of them we do with ARC in conjunction. We have a family and community resource library, and we help families navigate what we call the complex educational and community programs. So that's what we do at Parent Education. Our goal for tonight is really to give you some tools to use in this workshop to improve your child's education. Like Karen, I am a parent as well. And we look at this as in that parent lens is, have you ever felt emotional at an IEP? Karen and I are both parents of adults now, but I was emotional at every single one of my child's IEPs. Whether they were wonderful IEPs, whether I had some concerns or not, it was my child. And so it was a more of an emotional experience. I attended hundreds as a professional and never cried at one, but I was always emotional at my own child's. We look at parents being confused either during the IEP or maybe when you leave the IEP about what did we agree on and what were they talking about, how to interpret some of this data that's being given us. I know there's times when I wish that I had spoken up at a meeting and asked more questions or given more insight or had more to say about what the IEP was going to include. And I also had times, and I'm sure many of you have as well, when there was something I said during the meeting where I thought, oh, I probably should not have said that. I gave too much information, or I asked a question that might have let them think that I didn't know what I was talking about. And so we want to kind of give you some tools to address some of these concerns that parents and family members have. The tools we are going to use are the Charting the Life Course tools. They are from the Missouri Family to Family program out of University of Missouri, Kansas City Institute for Human Development. These tools have been developed over many years by individuals with developmental disabilities family members, professionals, both in school systems and provider agencies, working together to really look at what kind of tools can we use and develop to help people in their planning, problem solving, and for a good life. Is a national community of practice. These are some of the other states that utilize these Charting the LifeCourse tools. They're used by many schools, provider agencies, and government agencies. There are some of the states even require that everyone has the Charting the LifeCourse ambassador training to even be a provider for people with developmental disabilities. So St. Louis is not alone. Missouri is not alone. We are in good company with a lot of states. So the key principles of Charting the Life Course, we focus on all people. So these tools are not just meant for one age range or one area of life. We recognize, I think in that second one, the person within the context of their family. We look at this for all of our planning, but especially when we're looking at a student, we're looking at your child in the context of their family and their community, because we know that families are always going to be there and the biggest part of their life. We look at the trajectory across the lifespan, both current and future. What are we doing now and how do we get to where we want to go? We look at those life achieving life outcomes of self-determination, about building community inclusion, about economic self-sufficiency. It's a holistic approach across all the life domains. So each one of those little icons we'll describe in a little bit later goes across not just math and reading, but we're looking at all of the different areas that your child lives and works and plays. We look at it through three buckets of support. The three buckets that we always talk about in Charting the Life Course are discovery and navigation, how we help you get to where you're going, connecting and networking. We find that families who work together and network across other agencies or with other families have better satisfaction and better outcomes. And then what are the real goods and services that are needed to meet those goals? The integrated services across the life course is a really important concept within Charting the Life Course tools. Each one of those colors on the star represents an area that we look at in goal setting or problem solving. And we'll explain a lot more about that later. And Karen will give you some real life examples. And then we also look at transforming policy and system change, about bringing advocacy and really helping families have a voice in this system. So Charting the Life Course is about having different conversations or having those conversations in a different way, sometimes difficult. It's a different way of thinking. We think it encourages high expectations. It utilizes the life experience to move in a direction towards those high expectations. And we use multiple types of support and integrate those into the life system or the life. It's not only for professionals to use. Well, our students utilize it themselves and they really get it. Sometimes we have students that when they're using the trajectory and they're putting down some of the things in there, they're like, oh, that aha moment. So they're not just for professionals and it's not just about the tools. If you've seen Charting the Life Course tools before, you've come to a workshop, we use these tools and this framework for a lot of our different trainings and workshops and support groups. You see that the tools sometimes change and we'll have a couple of different ones tonight. But it's not about the tools. It's really about that thought process, about thinking different, about that holistic approach. It's not a program and it's not designed for one specific age group. It is across the lifespan, which from infancy all the way to aging. And it's not just for people with disabilities. We use this all the time in our own lives. Once you get this way of kind of thinking through problem solving or goal setting, you'll use it in all kinds of areas of your life. So now we're going to talk about the supports, services, and how they've evolved. In that very first graphic, we see the person surrounded by their family, and their community. That's what we want. But traditionally, in the disability services and in school services, we have taken that student and surrounded them by services and actually kind of separated them from their family and community, providing we have the answer for what you need, and it's based here. But in that third graphic, that's what we really want to see, is those stars, the integrated support stars, are wherever they're needed. They honor the family and community with the person in the center of it, and we provide the services and supports where they're needed, looking at all of those different areas that we're going to discuss in just a few minutes. So what does a good life mean? People say all the time, that is so broad, that is so big, because that's kind of the tenet of Charting the Life course, is supporting the good life. And it means different things for all of us. It could also not mean my good life overall, but like tonight, we're discussing what might a good IEP mean, IEP mean for my child, or what might this week mean? Again, we look at achieving the outcomes connected to these life domains. In education, we look a lot at those academics, but we always have to be mindful in planning for our child's good life to look at these other areas of healthy living. What's going on medically, behaviorally? How about nutrition and wellness, affordable care? Safety and security is one that we hear from families a lot about, how to handle emergencies, about legal issues and legal rights. I get questions all the time about guardianships and what are options and alternatives to guardianship. Citizenship and advocacy, about being valued, a valued person in the context of your community, and being able to make your own goals and choices. Daily life and employment, that one is, we can connect pretty easily to the IEP process. What is it going to look like in your school day? What is our long-term goal for when we're done with school? Community living, we want to make sure that we've looked at those home adaptations and modifications. This might not seem to have a fitting place in the IEP process, but it's so important that your school team understands what your living looks like, what kind of transportation is a barrier, or what community access do we need extra help with? And then social and spirituality. I think we've learned even more over the course of this pandemic that friends and relationships, opportunity to have leisure and recreation is so important for that well-being for our family members and our children. Now we're going to get into the special education part of this and kind of help make the connections now that we have a little bit of understanding of the framework. So IDEA, the purpose of special education law, is to ensure that all children with disabilities have available to them a free and appropriate public education, or FAPE, that emphasizes special education and related services designed to meet their This is where the tools really ring true to me. Unique needs, and prepare them for future education, employment, and independent living. So it's not just I get to the reading level in second grade, but it is to prepare me for the most independent living and the best future possible. And then also to ensure the rights of children with disabilities and parents are protected. So what's in the IEP? Well, each child's IEP must contain specific information, and it's listed in IDEA, the federal special education law. Where we want to go, though, is to build a different system, to shift from that compliance mentality to really a student-centered approach, where the student has a strong voice and choice in what their goals are and how to reach them, so that there's a true team approach. That slide earlier when I talked about families being emotional and sometimes not feeling part of that IEP, using some of these tools in planning or tracking your child's IEP will make you feel more involved, focusing on the student's vision. Sometimes when we sit down with a student and we look at what their vision for a good life is, Families are sometimes surprised at the things that their children have thought about and what they would like to do. And creating a plan using backward design, and that's a term that we use in special school district in our self-determination training. All backward design is knowing where you want to go and how to get there. So we use it in our everyday life as adults. So I might think my family wants a specific dinner tomorrow night. So I have a recipe. That's my goal, is that recipe. And then I work my way backward and say, what's in my pantry that I already have? What do I need to the grocery store to get? Are there tools that I don't own in my kitchen, or spices, or do I have the time to make that recipe tomorrow night? We look at that end goal and work our way backward to ensure that we have all of those components for a good IEP and a good life for our children. And then the prioritization and identification of services and experiences and actions that are going to close that gap between where the student is and the vision. So the IEP answers the following questions. What's the vision for my child? What does the student know and do well? What will this year's annual goals and objectives be? What services are needed, and how will they be provided? One of the tools in Charting the Life course that I think really pairs up well with the IEP process and the present level of performance is this one-page profile. And we're going to give you an example. Karen's going to walk you through it in just a minute. It goes through, it's a little blurry on my end, but what people like and admire about me, always so important to start with that with your child. To prepare for an IEP and to ask those questions and to build those skills so that they can talk about the things that people like and admire about them. What's important to your child? And this doesn't have to just be in the classroom. What's important in life? And then how to best support me? Again, we hear from students when we sit down and we do the portfolio and the one-page profile, really different things. They have some great insight sometimes about what supports them the best and what's important to them. And we want their voice. We know we get better buy-in when we're all part of that choice making and goal setting. And then here's the trajectory. This is where we look at the vision for what you want. And again, this could be for the IEP year. This could be, you could use it to plan your vacation. You could use it to plan for healthier living. You could use it for a lot of different issues. But what is it that you want? And then what you don't want? We do find working with families that sometimes it's easier identifying what they don't want. And it's oftentimes, in the big scheme of things, some universal things. As a mom, I don't want my child to live in poverty or to have an unhealthy life or to live someplace where they don't want to live or with people that they don't want to live with. What I do want for them to have is really a meaningful daytime activities where they feel fulfilled, where they're surrounded with friends in their community, in the faith-based organization that we've chosen, and they get to make all of these choices. So the line that kind of goes up and the box is, what is it that we either are doing to get to that vision for what we want, or what is it that we might need what we want for that vision? And then the bottom box and the dotted line is, are we doing some of the things that are taking us to where you don't want to be? So if my vision for a healthier life and what I don't want is to not be able to play with my grandchildren all the time and have health problems, but I'm eating a blizzard every day, that's taking me to what I don't want. So you can see when we start mapping some of these things out, we really get to see where we are, what we're doing well, and what we might need to add to get to our vision of what we want and keep from the things that we don't want.
Okay, so this is an example of a trajectory that I completed, a fictitious person. I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to talk about how we can use it in the IEP process. So like Deb said, sometimes we we have a lot of challenges trying to figure out what we do want. And sometimes we have to start with what I don't want. And that's where I'm going to start. So things that I don't want for my child. I don't want Sally to be dependent on systems for support. I don't want Sally to be isolated. I don't want her to not have friends. I don't want her to not have learned how to effectively communicate her wants and needs. And I don't want her to continue to use inappropriate behaviors to get her wants and needs met. So that's kind of really kind of focusing on what, you know, a family might be dealing with right now. When I look at my vision for my family member's good life, and by the way, this will be in your handout so you can see that example. The one that Deb was referring to earlier, that was for the individual. And this is what's so cool about the tools is that, like Deb was saying, a parent can complete it for their child and an individual can complete it for themselves. I also like to have both parents complete it separately because sometimes our visions are different and it's really good to get all of these different perspectives. The other difference about this trajectory here is that it splits what are we doing to get to our good life and what might we be doing that is taking us towards our what we don't want into two parts, using past life experiences and then what can we do moving forward. I like this split one because it can help me identify barriers that we might need to problem solve around and overcome. But back to my vision for my family member's good life. This is what you can use for your parent concerns. What I always suggest to parents when you are writing your parent concerns or sharing your parent concerns for the IEP process, that you certainly talk about what are your concerns for this next IEP cycle. But beyond that, we need to make sure that our team has a vision and knows what your vision is for your child. Or if you want to involve your child, what your child's vision is as well. And just an FYI, when we talk about self-determination and self-advocacy and all of those things, I also suggest to include your child in on his or her IEP meetings as early as possible. It doesn't have to be for the whole IEP meeting. It can just be for parts of it to share their vision of their good life and things that they want to accomplish and things that they don't like. And I think that really starts that pathway to that self-determination early and helps them learn about their disability and how to advocate for themselves. But back to parent concerns, when we're writing those parent concerns, I also ask parents to think about what is that next transition state? So when you're transitioning from preschool to kindergarten or elementary school to middle school to high school, those expectations can change. And what do you foresee for your child and where would you like your child to be? So we have those stepping stones to reach as we move forward on the trajectory on our individual's life. And then definitely that long-term. If we don't share with our team what our long-term vision is for our child, other team members may have a different vision and will provide services and supports and instruction that will take them in a different direction. And then that's what kind of causes that strife and that disagreement in the IEP meeting. So in this example, for this student, current vision is to learn the same academic level as her peers, build meaningful friendships with peers, be able to communicate her wants and needs effectively without resorting to behaviors, learn appropriate strategies to get her wants and needs met. And then as we look a little bit into the future, to be able to independently participate in the general education setting, to be able to advocate for herself and what she needs. But as as Deb had alluded to, those long-term goals, I think, is what every parent wants for all of their children, to have meaningful relationships and do the things that she enjoys with friends and families, to be independent, not need adult support, to further her education after high school in whatever way she chooses, to be competitively employed, to live in a setting of her choice with or without others. So I think it's like Deb said, these tools give us an opportunity to look at what that end goal is and to work backwards. If that's our end goal, how are we going to get there? And then as you look at those past life experiences of what have we done that helps get us to the good life, this lists things like being connected to peers, having opportunities to build friendship with peers, talking through options when Sally shows she's signs she's becoming escalated, giving Sally time to process information and choices. So those are things that can be included in the IEP, either in accommodations or modifications, or maybe depending on what those supports are, it could be a service, you know, like a social skills group or something like that. But it can give us an idea or give us a focus on what types of things we need to put in place in order to support your child in reaching their good life. And it just provides a way to organize that. If we look at things that we want to stay away from, forcing a choice Sally doesn't want or is able to achieve, keeping her away from peers and other preferred people as a form of punishment. So it's a really good way to communicate those things that, you know, we need to keep this out of the IEP. We need to make sure these barriers to reaching our good life are not being provided as part of the support, and that we're aware of that. But moving forward, it helps us look at what we need to focus on. So we need to teach Sally coping strategies to use when she is frustrated. We need to teach Sally to understand what she is feeling. We need to teach Sally effective ways to communicate. I think moving forward, we want to make sure that we stay away from those barriers, a rigid behavior support plan that is not flexible enough to adjust to Sally's needs in the moment. So it's a really, really nice way to organize your thoughts and have those that discussion with your team so that we can implement the appropriate services and support.
So we know we have the components of the IEP that are required, the present level, the special considerations page, the goals, the minutes, the service, the accommodations. How do we make this less about compliance and more about the student and family voice? We use these tools, and these are the ones that we utilize a lot. Are again, that trajectory, the one-page profile, the integrated support star, and something that we call the family vision, where families sit down and really prioritize what it is that they want to work at. What are the priorities? It might be that this year, social skills are really important. And then the next year, it might be really planning for something else. We're going to discuss that integrated support star. And this is one of the favorite tools that families use as well. So that star that we talked about several slides ago, where it's integrated into the services where needed, but not separating your child from the family and community. These are the areas that we look at for those services. So how we utilize this tool is in the center, we would put a goal or a problem that we want to solve. And then we look at these different areas to see how we might reach that goal or solve that problem. I always like to start with personal strengths. What are your child's skills and personal abilities? What is their life experience that will help them in reaching that goal or solving that problem? Talk about their assets. Again, you need to practice this with our students to build that self-determination. Most of us, even as adults, really have a hard time maybe talking about our personal strengths and assets. So in that dinner planning, that recipe plan that I was talking about, I might utilize all of these areas to solve the problem of, I don't really know how to do this, but I am smart and I am a home economist, so I'll figure it out. Relationships. We want to look at other people who can help. My sister has every spice in the world, so I don't have to go and spend $6 on one kind of fancy smoked paprika. I can depend on my sister to help me with that. So what friends or family members or even acquaintances could actually help in solving this problem or setting this goal? Technology, we all have technology and we have so much more technology in our life, so that we don't always have to look for a person to solve a problem or set a goal. Is it a smartphone? Is it the use of assistive technology or environmental technology? Are the community-based supports that are available, like businesses, parks, the library, your faith-based community that could help in this? Again, we are looking at this holistic approach of understanding that we want our children to have that healthy living, good employment, social and spirituality. So we're looking at all of these. And lastly, that eligibility specific. We all use eligibility specific supports. And so it's not a bad area, but it's the one we probably have the least control over. So eligibility. What might your child be eligible for with state services or special education is an eligibility support. So this is kind of what it looks like without all of it filled in. There are several different ones that you'll find out there. Some of them are split, where you might have the personal strengths about what you have now and what you would like to look at as personal strength and technology. And what is at our fingertips now, but what might we add to technology to solve that problem or achieve that goal. So there's many different ones that are out there. Karen's going to go through a one-page profile again and using the integrated support star to kind of go through these different areas about using coping strategies.
Yeah, so the integrated support star is one of my favorite tools, because you can use it for so many different things. You can use it for that overall vision of your good life and how do I get there and, you know, the person in general, but I can break it down to a topic. I can break it down to a specific skill. So I'm going to go over the integrated support star first before I talk about the portfolio part of that and how we use that in the IEP. Building on the same situation for Sally uses behaviors to express her wants and needs, and they're maladaptive behaviors. So instead of using those behaviors, we want to teach her how to use coping strategies. So this support star focuses on that. I always start with personal strengths and assets first. I think one of the things that's so challenging and emotional about the IEP process is it seems to focus on our children's deficits and how do we fix our children. And I don't want to focus on my child's deficits. I don't want to fix my child. I want to support my child in becoming their best selves. And so I really like this mind shift of how we approach things. So in this situation for Sally, for her personal strengths and assets about using coping strategies, she is able to share what she's feeling after having a break and time to process information. So that's a strength that we can build on to help her use coping strategies. She can identify what was bothering her with some problem-solving help from a trusted adult. So again, that's something that we can build on. And she can identify what coping strategies help her. So she may not always access those coping strategies when she needs to, but she is able to say, no, I really do like this, or no, I don't like this. So those are all strengths that Sally has when we're working towards using coping strategies. When we look at the relationship part of that, she has relationships that can help her use those coping strategies, and that's with her counselor and her and two of her teachers. When we look at technology, which you wouldn't necessarily think, oh my gosh, is there technology that we can use for coping strategies? Well, there is. Computer games for Sally happen to help her de-escalate, kind of helps her take that mind break. And it doesn't have to be high tech technology, it can be low tech technology. And so also visual schedules and timers help remind her to use her breaks, how to use her breaks and her coping strategies. So you can think of technology very, very broadly. And this is the other thing that I love about the integrated support star, is that it's not just focused on that specialized instruction, those eligibility specific services. It helps us think about, what does everybody access to help with using coping strategies? And depending on the unique needs of the person, it will look differently for each person. For Sally, movement is something that really helps her cope and is one of her coping strategies. So in her world, that playground equipment helps meet her sensory needs and helps keep her regulated. And walking the hallways is a good coping strategy for Sally. And those are things that everybody can access. I don't have to go through an IEP process to use those supports to help Sally cope. And then we go to that eligibility specific corner there, the green color. And there we can put in what are those eligibility-specific supports that we need to provide Sally to help her use her coping strategies. And that would be specialized instruction by a counselor and special education teachers specific to her needs. Then the other part I kind of want to go over is the portfolio part. And these two top sections, what people like and admire about my family member and what I believe is most important to my family member. Those are things that can go into the present level of the IEP under strengths. And it's really nice to frame those strengths in that way, because we can build, like I said, we can build off of those strengths to help overcome some of those barriers so that our child can reach their good life. So in this situation, Sally is outgoing, she's smart, she's affectionate, she likes to help, she loves learning about the things that she is interested in. So I'm really going to take those things into consideration when I'm trying to figure out the supports that we need in place in order to help her get to her good life. What is important to her? And I think we've all kind of experienced this. If it's not meaningful to us, then we are less motivated to achieve. So it's really nice to focus on what's important to that individual to help motivate them to achieve their best life. So what's important to Sally is connecting to adults and having their attention, being able to play with her toys, not having to share her things with others, having a trusted adult provide her with immediate support when she is upset or dysregulated, not getting dirty, making sure her clothes are clean and nothing is on her hands or body, having time to do things she likes to do, having friends, and spending time with her family. So this is broad, but there's a lot of information in that section where we can use that information to build in supports, accommodations, and modifications for Sally so that she can help achieve her good life. The last section, what are the best strategies to support my family member or the individual or myself, if it's a person filling them out for themselves. Those are also things that can go into support services, accommodations, and modifications, whether it be a behavior support plan, or it can go into the present level of the IEP under how the disability affects or in changes of current functioning or the strengths. So, and this is actually kind of split into two parts, one from the parent perspective and then one specifically for school. So best strategies to support, asking her what she needs and responding to that identified need, choosing your battles. I think parents do that a lot. So not requiring her to fit into a specific expectation and being flexible and giving her options. And then we can also talk more specifically about those learning style and what kind of supports that the child needs.
So again, we really want to use these tools for parent perspective and for you to be more involved, for that shift in how we think about things. Increased student voice is so important to self-determination and to really that good life for students. We also find that parents who feel less or feel more involved in the planning for their child have improved satisfaction, and that self-determination and that parent planning results in a reduction of unnecessary guardianships, where we're using these supported decision-making, where families are having these conversations about setting goals and how to achieve them, about some of the things that your child will bring to the table and where they might need help, improves all of these areas. These are some of the foundation tools for the family perspective. Again, we have the kind of trajectory, the integrated support star, the one example of it. And the third one is that vision for families. And we go through all of those life domains in the IEP planning process, especially at transition. We might look at it and say, which is the most important thing right now for us to look at? So if I'm talking to a parent of a child that's getting ready to turn 18, we might be looking at safety and security first. That might be their top priority, about how we plan for alternatives to guardianship or what kind of things might need to be in place when they turn 18. So these are all tools that families can use in planning for that IEP process and for really to get the best goals, not just for school, but for life. This is a specific tool that Karen said she likes to use, the goal attainment tool. And it's kind of a cool little tool. It looks like this is what we should use for the IEPs all the time personally. And I'm going to let her kind of run through this too, because she uses it a lot more than I do.
Yeah, so I really, really like this tool. I think that when we're going through that IEP process as a parent, that sometimes those IEP goals, we don't necessarily understand exactly how that's going to work. They're written very technically, which they should, because we want very specific information for progress. But I think if we can frame the IEP goal in this way, we're using this goal attainment planning and tracking success sheet, it can help us as parents understand. So up at the top, you would list the goal. And what I really like is where it has the sections of define success, where it says describe what exceeds expected success would look like, describe what expected success looks like for this goal, or what the minimum success would look like for this goal. And I don't know that I would necessarily do those three specific things, but sometimes we can use those three categories for instead benchmarks, like at the beginning of the IEP cycle, that, you know, as long as they're progressing here or we're working on this, then we're on that trajectory to reach that good life or to reach that goal by the end of the IEP. Sometimes you can also use those three categories to determine how much prompting is done. So when we're teaching a new skill to an individual, sometimes we have to prompt a lot at the beginning before they can do it independently. So we can describe it that way. But you want to have a good picture of exactly what does it look like when, yes, they are doing what we want them to do. They are showing that they know that skill. And so it really, in my mind, helps me think about what does success look like? Can you describe that to me? The tracking, you know, you get quarterly reports on progress on goals. And I'm hoping that when you get those quarterly reports on progress on goals, that how that progress is being achieved is broken down into those benchmarks. So there might be a number of skills that we're looking at in this goal. It could be that, let's kind of go back to Sally using her coping strategies. And let's say that we're looking at her ability to identify the coping strategy and implement the coping strategy. And so I would hope that, we're getting information that says she's identifying the coping strategy to use, 80% of the time. She's implementing it independently without prompts 20% of the time, and with prompts, 60% of the time. So kind of using it to track that way. And also what is working and what is not working. It helps us identify those things that are going well, and then some of those barriers where we might need to change. So I do like using this to kind of help me understand how a goal in my child's IEP might be implemented and tracked.
In here, these are live links to the SSD IEP process that are not charting the life course, but about what is in an IEP, the IEP team, components of a quality IEP, all of that stuff, all of those things about the IEP process. Desi's Guide to Special Education is another way to get more information about the IEP process. What Karen and I don't want you to take away from tonight, or at least I don't want you to take away from tonight, is that you have to use all of these tools, that we're giving you a whole bunch of homework and just making more expectations on the parents once again to make sure that everything's done right. But you are the parents. We are the parents forever. My child's second grade teacher was fabulous, but only had him for the second grade. And he's still my child. And I'm still the one who's planning with him and for him and helping him with these decisions. These are just tools to start reframing the way that you think about planning for the future, setting goals, having high expectations, and utilizing these Charting the Life course tools as they make sense for you. And hopefully, as we move through the IEP process and we have more and more training with families and school personnel about utilizing these tools to really have meaningful discussions and do that pivot to more student voice and high expectations to reach their goals for a good life. You can get more information about the tools. There's short videos, there's tip sheets, there's all kinds of information at lifecoursetools.org. You can contact the Parent Education Program at ssdpeda@ssdmo.org or our main number, 989-8460. Here is Karen's information with the Family Advocacy and Community Training. Her address, if you just Google FACT, it will tell you all kinds of things about fact checking and everything else. So we wanted to make sure that everybody knew exactly how you can reach Karen and all of her team. They are a wonderful advocacy agency. We refer to them all the time in parent education and send people their way for help with advocating for the best possible IEP and goals for our students.
How can we help out children in middle and high school? I love this life course approach, but often feel that the focus is on my child's grades and not their social and emotional needs. I still feel powerless in their IEPs at the higher levels.
It's a pretty powerful tool to bring into the IEP for a middle schooler or an elementary about what your big goals are, what your little goals are. And it doesn't have to be getting to this reading level. Because as a parent, I'm worried about all of those, that holistic approach about, I want my child to have friends. Let's figure out what we're going to do to get there. I want my child to be included in the extracurricular activities that his peers are included in. What can we do to get there? And whether those are academic supports that might be needed or that social emotional component, absolutely, it belongs not just in the high school.
Yeah, and if you go back to the purpose of IDEA, as was listed in this presentation, the purpose is to prepare the individual for further education, employment, and independent living. And so even though we're required to develop a transition plan when they turn 16, we should be thinking about it all along, even in middle school. And like Deb said, that holistic approach, yes, we definitely want our kids to learn those academics, but we also want to build those friendships. We want to have them to have those social skills, those executive functioning skills, so that they can meet those expectations when they're in a job or in post-secondary education. And so I would again share that vision for the good life and kind of break those down. And you can always put those in your parent concerns as well. So I really feel like the Charting the Life course tools are just awesome for transition planning, because it really does help us think broadly about all of those life domains and what is our child's life going to look like after they leave high school. It's a very scary time for parents. And maybe Deb could talk more about how this is incorporated in SSD, but when the child turns 16, the IEP within where the child turns 16, we create a transition plan, and we have to have post-secondary employment and education goals, and if appropriate, independent living goals. And so it's a backwards process, like Deb was talking about, where we look at what is that end goal for education? What is that end goal for employment? And if appropriate, for independent living. And then we kind of work backwards and talk about what kind of supports and services and instruction do we need to provide to make sure that the individual can reach their post-secondary goals for those three areas. And the other thing that I like about using the Charting the Life course tools for transition purposes is that, you know, sometimes parents think because it's through the IEP process that the school district has to provide all of these services and supports in order for the child to meet their post-secondary goals. But just like the integrated support STAR, we can take components from many different areas, and the parent can contribute to providing some of those supports. Other support agencies outside of the school district can provide certain instruction and supports, as well as technology and different things like that. So the Charting Life course tools are just an excellent way to kind of build that framework for developing that transition plan. Do you have anything to add, Deb?
Yeah, that's all great information, Karen. We do have a transition department at Special School District. So you can ask for a transition facilitator or effective practice specialist to be involved in your child's transition plan. You can give us a call at Parent Education. It's probably what we get the most questions on about transitioning to adult life and how to plan for that. The ARC has lots of transition programs and opportunities for additional workshops that are based on that transition. It's a big time in families' lives and in our students' lives. So I think we put a lot of emphasis on transition. When we first started looking at Charting the Life course tools and framework as a district, that's where it started, is how do we plan for that big transition? And now we're trickling down to say, we need to start talking about supporting our students in making those decisions in middle school, in early childhood, in elementary school. We need to start building on these skills for families to have those visions and those high expectations, and to be able to kind of put those goals out there and work through those goals. we don't start being the best drivers when we first get our driver's licenses. Some of us never get to be great drivers, but it takes practice. And so utilizing these Charting the Life course tools, not just at the end when we're getting ready for that transition IEP or graduation or moving into vocational skills program or one of those other programs, we want to start this early and utilize these tools as a framework for how we think about transition and that backward planning of what is really that goal that we want to achieve and where do we not want to end up at the end of the day? And then how do we get there, both in our school, in our community, and with our provider agencies, our families? Like Karen said, that's why we both really like that the integrated support star, because it makes you start to think about all of those different ways that you can reach those transition goals.
We have another question, which is, how do you go about getting this process started with their current IEP?
So you can always bring these tools to your team. It's not rocket science. You bring a trajectory that says, this is my goal for my child, and help me figure out how we're going to reach it. And these are the things I really don't want to see. I really don't want this to happen. And what are some of the things we might be doing or we need to avoid doing? The one-page profile or the portfolio to really talk about your child's strengths or to put it in a star. Teachers are starting to use this. We are integrating this throughout some trainings, and I don't want to get ahead of myself and announce anything yet, but we are doing professional development with schools, and these are easy tools for families to actually bring and feel like they're more in control. So it doesn't have to be a formal thing where your teacher's been specifically trained in Charting the Life course tools. You absolutely, as family members, and as really important members of the team who know your child the best, can utilize these tools in planning for and helping write a quality IEP.
So what can we do if we feel that our concerns or goals as parents are being ignored?
Well, at Special School District, there is a chain of communication. You can find that on our website under the partner district about who to talk to first, where to go next. You should always talk to the person who is closest to your child first. We do this a lot with parents where they don't feel like they are being heard. And so we pull out the trajectory and have them really say, these are my goals. These are my concerns. And I don't feel like we're getting there. And it's a really powerful thing, not about you're not doing a good job or you're not listening to me, to have that and say, look at this. This is a concrete example of what my concerns are or what my goals are, and help me reach them. If that teacher, that case manager doesn't have the answers, there are the special education coordinators. They have directors. We have all the way up, and you can find the ones beyond your teacher and your case manager on the SSD website.
Parents can use the tool, but is there an age that's best to bring the school into the conversation? Is there an age that's too young?
I don't think there's an age that's too young. I think that I've always felt that, you know, that trajectory towards our vision starts at the beginning. And I think it's that way for all of our children. It just requires a lot more planning when we have a child with a disability. Like I said, in parent concerns, I always break that down into three parts: to what my current concerns are for this year, midterm, and then long-term. So I don't think any time is too early.
Yeah. And it doesn't even have to be words. Looking at pictures, again, maybe start planning, not with my child is four and this is what they're going to be when they're an adult, but start planning for smaller things to build up those skills, to talk to them about just about decision-making and about what they like and what they don't like. Those are all important steps to get to that point where we're planning these great transition plans for adult life. Most little ones say, I do it. I do it, me do it, I do it myself. They're born with self-determination. We need to encourage that and have them part of that conversation. And so even if they have unrealistic four-year-old expectations to be a super sleuth ninja, that I don't think they're going to be, let's talk about what kind of skills we can develop. You need to go to gymnastics class if you want to be a ninja, or what it is. This is your goal. I'm going to help you figure out how to reach your goal and to have a better life. And to,
if you think about it, it's the same thing we do for, you know, our kids, where they start showing an interest and success. You know, we respond to what they're interested in and what they like. And so we follow that and we get them enrolled in baseball or gymnastics or whatever. So it's the same thing. Yeah. So not only with the school, but and you don't have to pull out the actual tools, but just using that framework to make sure that your child is involved in that process as well. At what point does your child need an IEP? Well, that's a little bit more complicated. And you may want to contact F.A.C.T. for services. You have to meet eligibility criteria to have an IEP. So there is no hard and fast rule that they have to be 2 years behind in order to qualify for an IEP. When we're looking at eligibility, we look at a lot of different things besides academics. We look at language, we look at social skills, and we look at how they're functioning in the school environment as a whole. But there is a very specific process. And if you need assistance with that, we may be able to assist you with that. And you can contact us or Debra. What kind of support do you have for a parent who is going through that initial process?
Yeah, and we've got lots of information about the evaluation process and kind of the steps. And Desi's got lots of great information too about the qualifying for special education and the different categories that you might qualify under.
And then, is there an age limit for requesting IEPs beyond high school? When is the best time to request one? Are IEPs something that exist at the college level, the university level?
No. Deb, do you want to take it or?
No. Yeah. Well, and when you were talking about IEPs that might go away and to really build those other skills, when our students leave the school, that eligibility is gone. That free and appropriate public education is gone. So that's one of the things using the Charting the LifeCourse Tools we've found is that we look at students who really have goals for post-secondary education, but we are modifying curriculum or we're building in accommodations that they will not be able to get in post-secondary education. And so that safety net is there up until it's not. And so utilizing that goal setting to really look and say, in my child's future employment, what kind of skills will they need to have to self-advocate? In their post-secondary education, what are some of the things? I would always encourage families to go through their access office to have whatever can be provided, but there is no IEP in post-secondary education. Same way for many of our technical skills programs where the requirement is the requirements for licensure. And so that is not modified in the adult world. So building on those skills, knowing where you want to be helps in that backward design of getting to where that goal is.
Yeah, and I'll just add that, so the IDEA, where you have that IEP, is for ages 3 through 21.
Yeah.
And then beyond that, individuals with disabilities can receive accommodations under Section 504, both in the post-secondary education setting, whether that be a technical school or a university or trade school or whatever, and also under the ADA. The requirement is a little bit different. It's called, the requirement is equal access, or the standard is equal access, and accommodations should be provided. You just need to request them, as long as it doesn't fundamentally alter that program. So a little bit of legalese there, but there are some protections, and you can receive some accommodations.
I want to thank both Karen and Deb for being here this evening and for all of the participants' questions and comments. It really made for a wonderful evening. Thank you all so much.